Good morning. Welcome to Forest Park. We light our candle as we begin our service this morning. As usual, I hope that you will have your elements ready to share later, time for communion, as well as whatever you might need for our time of stewardship. Let's begin the service this morning and sing together, "Joyful, Joyful, We Adore You."
Please join me in prayer. God of the Most High, we gather to honor and glorify you. Receive our invitation to dwell with us in this space. Enfold us in your presence and fill us again with holy awe and mystery. We are yours and we claim you as our God. In your Son's name we pray. Amen.
Dead, and he is Lord. Every knee shall bow, every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord.
So during this time of prayer and thanksgiving, I would like us to be especially mindful of the people that have no one to pray for them during this time. Let us lift those up during our prayer time this week. Those that will not or cannot ask. Those that do not know where to turn. And those who have no one to check on them. We're all checking on each other during this time, and it's wonderful to be a part of a community of faith. There are others that do not have that benefit. So let us lift those up during this time. And in that same light, please remember those who have sacrificed so much for us on this Memorial Day weekend. Please join me for a few moments of silent meditation and personal reflection, followed by our prayer. Will you pray with me? Holy and gracious God, we come to you because you are the source of life and love. Holy God, there are times when we are uncertain. Uncertain in our faith, uncertain in our relationships, uncertain to be on this earth. Be with us, strengthen us, and uphold us. As we attempt to live out the teachings presented by your Son on the Sermon on the Mount, it is hard. Be with us and strengthen us as we go forward in this journey we call faith. And as your Son taught so many of those to pray long ago, we also join with them by saying, Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. During this time of stewardship, the mandate to give of yourself has not been changed. During this time of physical separation, we are called to give out of our abundance. We are also called to give out of our scarcity. This movement involves sacrifice. And that being said, if you are in need of financial assistance, especially during this time, please, please reach out to me. Call me. You can email me at revbillhim@gmail.com and let me know, and we will see if we can help. Because we all, again, need to come together during this time of physical separation. Now, there are many ways that you can give to Forest Park Christian Church. We have Tithely on our website, which is located on our offerings tab. You can also send in a check. You can also drop off a check in our mailbox here that's checked once a day. So we will now receive this morning's offering.
Join me as we sing the hymn, What a Friend We Have in Jesus.
So many different ways to do communion and to celebrate the Lord's Supper. Now, last week, I had a hot dog bun up here, and I got called out on it, and it's fine, it's good. That was our little communion, but wait to see what I have left here. Look at this! This right here is a massive hot dog bun. See, the small and the large. We can all celebrate communion together. Now, when Jesus was betrayed, he gathered with his closest friends in the upper room. He took bread that was smaller than this, and he broke it. And he said, Take, eat, for this is my body. After the meal, He lifted up the cup. He said, "This is the cup of the new covenant poured out for all for the forgiveness of sins. Do this also in remembrance of me." Everyone is welcome at the Lord's table. We invite you to communion at this time.
Thank you.
So normally we start off with scripture and then I pray and then we have the sermon. Clearly Steve just sang beautifully our scripture. It was either me singing it or Steve singing it. And so we opted with Steve. I hope our gamble paid off here. So please join me in prayer. Lord God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Good morning. It is good to be here today in whatever way you are connecting with us this morning. So last week we looked at a whole lot of information about what Jesus did as he was challenging the understanding of the day, challenging religion and economics and loyalty and the radical nature of God's all-inclusivity. But today we're going to look at something that is central to the Sermon on the Mount, due to the way Matthew thematically orchestrates this sermon here, and that is prayer. Prayer's right in the middle of the Sermon on the Mount. Prayer is very important to us at Forest Park as well. We pray like 8 times in our worship services when we are gathered in person here. But again, Jesus is not presenting yet another prayer that we can just use in addition to all of our prayers. He's saying this is the way to pray. Jesus is reimagining the use and the content of prayer. So the teachings about prayer start off in chapter 6, and where Jesus warns against people praying for the sake of others looking at them and congratulating them, praying for others instead of praying for God. So, and he says the hypocrites love to do that, love to stand up and be acknowledged and be recognized because of their long, lofty prayers. I remember being in seminary and being so jealous that when called on, people can just rattle off these awesome, amazing, lofty prayers, very ornate in nature. They would start off either the class or worship service and go, "Betty, would you mind praying for us here?" And Betty go, "Sure thing. Let us bow our heads. Holy Spirit, you have hovered over the waters at creation and bless us with the power to strength for opportunity for the world to work." And in the middle of this prayer, I normally am lifting up going, is she reading that? What's going on here? What's happening here? Right? And because sometimes they would ask me to pray and it would go something like this. Okay, let us bow our heads. Jesus, I love you and you love me apparently. And I just wanted to say that, amen. It's ridiculous, right? I mean, I fumble all over the place when I don't have something in front of me to say to God. Now, Jesus isn't saying that it's bad to pray in front of people. Jesus is saying the motivation behind why we pray is so very important. While I was still in seminary and still in Arkansas at First Christian Church in Fayetteville, I had there was a Christmas party that they host every year, and my best friend, his name's Gary, he hosts this party. And actually, I go to it still every single year, but this is when I was still living in Arkansas, but still in seminary. And so, as much as I love the limelight on me, and I want attention directed toward me, and the spotlights all should point toward me, my friend Gary is the exact opposite. He wants no attention. He wants no one looking at him, all sorts of stuff, right? It gives him anxiety for him to be in front of people in that way, right? And so he always gathers me up. He says, hey, won't you gather everybody up and go over the rules for Dirty Santa and everything? I'm like, okay. So I'm yelling gregarious, hey, let's all get together and you draw your numbers and you pick a gift and you can steal. And so after I explained it, we should have just started, but I was feeling a little bit ornery, I guess. And so I go, okay, so before we get started here, Gary's going to lead us in a word of prayer. There's like 35 people in this room. And you know, you may think it's mean, and in fact, it probably was, but I was just kind of funny, you know, that was going to put him on the spot like that. And I was certain to my soul that he was going to go, no thanks, we're not going to do that. And then I would pray, and then we would start the Dirty Santa exchange. But he didn't. He goes, all right, let's bow our heads. And I still thought he was joking. And I looked around the room, everyone started bowing their heads, and I'm like, all right, I guess I'll bow my head now. And he launched into one of the most beautiful prayers I have ever heard in my life. It wasn't in a church setting. It was in a Christmas party setting. He was thanking God for everyone being there and And he was acknowledging our fellowship together. But what was awesome about it is it was just him and God talking. And we all got to experience, listen in and experience what this prayer was. When the motivation is pure, prayer is quite, quite powerful. So after Jesus tackles the motivations behind why we pray, he then goes over to how to pray. And the Lord's Prayer is here in Matthew as part of the Sermon on the Mount. In fact, you might say that if prayer is the central point of the Sermon on the Mount, the Lord's Prayer is the central point of the central point of the theme of the Sermon on the Mount. It's also located in Luke in a different context when the disciples ask Jesus how they should pray. They present the prayer differently. It's small, yet maybe some meaningful differences between the way Matthew and Luke present this prayer. But before we get to the content of this prayer, this ever-powerful prayer, let's examine what is not in this prayer that Jesus presents as a model. The Lord's Prayer is prayed by all Christians, yet it never mentions Christ. It is prayed in all churches, yet it never mentions church. It is prayed on all Sundays, but it never mentions Sunday. It's called the Lord's Prayer, and it's never mentioned. The word Lord is not in there. It is prayed by Bible-believing Christians, but it never mentions the inerrancy of Scripture, the virgin birth, the miracles, the atoning death, or even the resurrection of Christ. It is prayed by evangelical Christians, but it never mentions the gospel. It is prayed by Pentecostal Christians, but it never mentions ecstasy or the Holy Spirit. It is prayed by denominational Christians, but it never mentions congregations, priests, bishops, popes, regions, districts. It doesn't mention any of those things. It is prayed by Christians who have split from one another over doctrinal disputes, and yet it never mentions a single one of those doctrines. It is prayed by Christians who focus on Christ's substitutionary atonement for human sin, but it never mentions Christ, substitution, sacrifice, or atonement. It is prayed by Christians who focus on the next life, going to heaven or going to hell, yet it never mentions going to either place. Now, I didn't invent that entire list. I got a lot of that from a book called The Greatest Prayer by John Dominic Crossan. But it is so interesting to see what we focus on, the plethora of what Christianity has become, what we as individual churches focus on, and the contrast that Jesus presents when he shows us how to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven. Now, Luke does not have the phrase, who art in heaven. That's just a Matthew thing. But I want to start with the first word, our. This is our. It's not a private prayer. It's meant to be shared with you and God, and it is meant to be personal, but it is not a private prayer. Our means we are doing this together. And that is why we say the Lord's Prayer in unison when we are here in this building. We start off and all say it together, right? I am so used to saying the prayer in unison with so many voices contributing to that prayer. And I don't know if anyone picks up on this, but Franklin mutes my mic during the Lord's Prayer. I don't know if anybody notices it. I noticed it years and years ago, and I asked him about that. And he said, I said, are you meaning to do that? And he was like, yeah, because it's our prayer. We're not just following your lead. All of us are praying. I'm like, oh, I love it. I absolutely love that he does that. And so because he does that, I'm just one of the people in the congregation praying this prayer with the support of everyone here. But when we started recording these services right here, when I'm up here by myself, I can't tell you how many times James has had to restart because I would forget lines in the Lord's Prayer. I'm sorry that I am admitting this to you, but truly, I would forget lines in this prayer that I have known since I was a baby almost, right? I get so nervous. Look at this. I printed the slide that everyone sees when we are here in worship because I didn't want to forget the words to the Lord's Prayer. Do not tell anyone. The next word is Father, our Father. I'm a huge believer. If you have spent any time with me or paid attention in my sermons, I am a huge believer of inclusive language when referring to God. I know the damage that it has done and the sexism it has propagated. So I just want to name that for me and for everyone else here. But this designation, that Jesus is giving God here is not about identifying God's gender as a male protector or something like that. The problem is how we translate the word Abba in Greek. So in Jewish and in Greek circles, it was not uncommon for people to refer to God as Father, like the formalized word of Father. But Jesus isn't using that word at all. Abba is most likely like dad or daddy, right? And it's not in a mocking sort of way. It's a really intimate, familial relationship with God, right? So Jesus isn't necessarily trying to dictate the gender of God, right? Jesus is relating to his dad or his daddy. And it wasn't baby talk, it was family talk. So when Jesus says, our Father, he is stating that God is, of course, my dad, but he's your dad too. Hallowed be thy name. Hallow means to honor or to keep holy, keeping God's name holy. How in the world are we supposed to keep God's name holy? Well, let's start off by asking a different question. What is God's name? You have to go all the way back to Exodus to find the exchange between Moses and God when the subject of the name came up. I don't know if you remember the story, but Moses sees a burning bush, but the bush was not consumed. So he climbs up the mountain and he wants to experience and wants to see this bush that does not burn up. And of course, because so, he has a conversation with the Almighty. And so God says, you are to deliver my people from bondage and from oppression. And in that conversation, Moses goes, okay, that's cool, but hey, what's your name? Like people might ask me, and so I'd like to tell them what your name is. And God says, I am what I am, or I will be what I will be. But Moses, right now, I am telling you to deliver the oppressed. So how in the world are we supposed to keep God's name holy? Deliverance of the oppressed, the impoverished, and the defenseless, which is right in line with what Jesus in his life and his purpose and his teachings, especially on the Sermon on the Mount, is all about. Deliverance from oppression. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. Once again, this is very clear evidence that the kingdom is not some realm that we go to only after we die. Jesus is praying for the kingdom to come here right now. And your will be done is a phrase added by Matthew. It's actually not in Luke. Do we think this part of the prayer is Jesus asking God for God to make God's will done here on earth? Is that what we think? Because we got to read that line again. Because if God's will is to be done on earth, who do you think that Jesus is actually referring to in this prayer? Folks, that's us. That is our, and when we pray, we are saying we are going to bring forth this kingdom. We're going to, thy kingdom come, thy will be done. We are saying we are going to be accomplishing that, right? And all of Jesus' teachings here in the sermon and elsewhere are tools and lessons to bring forth this kingdom. Give us this day our daily bread. There have been several attempts to understand what Jesus means by daily bread. Could it possibly be that Jesus is referring to the messianic banquet at the end of the age, where the end of the world is brought to fruition and we get to dine in the messianic banquet with daily bread? Is he referring to that? No, I don't think he's referring to that at all. Another idea is maybe it's communion. Maybe Jesus is referring to communion. Maybe it's Eucharistic in nature. That's really important. It's definitely important here. Do you think that's what he means? I do not. The answer to that question is no for me. You know what it means? It means bread. Let's not overthink this, all right? It's daily bread. It's sustenance for existence. Right here, Jesus is identifying with the poor. Why? Because Jesus is poor as well. We can all relate. Every one of us can relate to the need for food, the need for sustenance. But be warned, such praying constitutes a readiness of those who have bread to share with those who have none. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Now, Luke uses sins instead of debts. And of course, King James Version has trespasses. It is this point in public prayer where if you are at a different church setting than you are familiar at, you might start getting a little soft in the way that you are saying the Lord's Prayer in unison, because this is where all the churches kind of go in different directions. At Forest Park, we say, "Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us." And by the way, have you ever tried to tell someone without using those words what we say in the Lord's Prayer at Forest Park? Like, we can, like, sometimes we go, yeah, we use debts and debtors, or we use trespasses, but it's so awkward to say what we do, right? I told somebody before, we do sins at Forest Park Christian Church. What does that even mean, we do sins, right? There was someone else that said, I go, hey, by the way, we use sin language in the Lord's Prayer. And they're like, what are you talking about? Is it R-rated? I'm like, no, that's not what I mean. It was really hard to come up with telling people how we pray the Lord's Prayer here. Matthew has debts and debtors. I actually grew up on debts and debtors as well. People want to spiritualize this. Luke clearly wants to spiritualize this teaching. But it's not just a metaphor for sin. It clearly is, because our debts to God, that might be sin, right? And so we don't have monetary debts to God, but let's not just think that this is a spiritual teaching. There are monetary implications here as well. Jesus talked about money more than any other subject, so clearly his metaphor here is not just meant for spirituality. And every time we pray this prayer in this way, we are asking God to forgive us in the same manner that we forgive others. Think about that implication. Is that really the prayer that we want to be saying? There is no part of me that wants God to treat me the way that I treat other people. But you know what? If we're going to say this prayer, then we have to start treating others the way that we want God to treat us, starting with forgiveness. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. I had a seminary professor who refused to say the line, "Lead us not into temptation." He said that his God does not lead people into temptation. And last year, I don't know if you saw it, last year Pope Francis approved the changing of the Lord's Prayer to "Let us not fall into temptation." He said because the way we have translated over the years is not correct. He says because that speaks of a God who induces temptation. The book of James chapter 1 says that God tempts no one and tests no one. And I have a problem with this line as well, being in the Lord's Prayer. That is not my understanding of the holy. But as we expressed last week, let's not make Jesus in our image. Matthew and Luke both have this line in their presentation of the Lord's Prayer, which means we can probably tie that back to the historical Jesus. Here is Bill Hymn's take on "Lead us not into temptation." When we follow Jesus, Sermon on the Mount style, we are leaving comfort and familiarity behind. And you will embark on a journey that puts you at odds with the standards of this world. You will be tested and you will be tempted. We're all humans. And at some point on this faith journey, we're going to look over and that grass is going to be so much greener than we remember it on the world's side. So is God actually doing the one that is God the one that is testing? Not directly, but being on this path, we get tested. It was actually Satan or the accuser that tempted Jesus while he was in the desert, but the Spirit of the Lord drove him out to the desert. God is not playing cosmic games to see if we would stay on the straight and narrow, but this road contains all kinds of trials. So lead us not into temptation, but when we start to stray, deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. That ending, that doxology was not in either Matthew or Luke. It was clearly added much, much later by the church as kind of an ending to this prayer. It's also the part that if you're Catholic, you don't say. Like, just the priest says that, or the one leading worship. Everybody else doesn't say that line, and just the priest says that. And so I was at a wedding of a childhood friend, a long time ago, like 18 years ago, and I was a groomsman up there, and it was in a Catholic ceremony. My family was also in attendance, and we launched into the Lord's Prayer. And I remembered that the Catholic Church stopped before we stopped, but I didn't remember which line it was. So we got to about the middle of the prayer, and I intentionally didn't say the first word of each line, knowing that they're going to stop at some point. And so we get to this point, "For thine is the kingdom." And of course, I didn't say that first word. No one else said it, and so I knew to stop. But my family, who was in the congregation, did not know to stop. And so I was listening for them. I heard my dad clearest of all. I mean, they're sitting there going, "For thine is the kingdom and the power and the..." And it was wild, man. It's a good ending, right? It's a good ending to this prayer. It's not in Matthew or in Luke. It's not biblical. I still like the ending, though. So to sum it up, God, who is as close to us as a trusted family member, your name is to be holy. How is that? Through justice. It's always through justice. If the kingdom comes and your will is to be done, we recognize that that's us, and we're going to get moving immediately. We're going to need a couple things. Daily bread is something that we will need. Forgiveness is something that we will need, and we're going to try to forgive as well. And help us when temptation brings us off of the path, help us get back onto that path. That's it. It's simple, it's powerful, and it is of God. When the disciples asked for a lesson in prayer, Jesus gave them a lesson on the nature of God. We would do well to listen to that teaching and then pray accordingly. Thanks be to God. Amen. So simple, and yet so, so powerful. Now, next week is going to be the last week in our sermon series on the Sermon on the Mount. But next week is also Pentecost, which is really fun. And we'll be celebrating the birth of the church. And it's the only time we get to decorate in red. And since we can't be here all together in red, put on some red PJs or something like that and join us next week as we celebrate Pentecost and, again, the conclusion of the Sermon on the Mount. Now, if you'd like a church home where we are just struggling like everyone else to do this thing together, then please reach out to me. My email is revbillhim@gmail.com. I'd love to have conversations with you about what it means to be a part of specifically this community of faith. Now, if you've never made that good confession that Jesus is the Christ, Son of the living God, please reach out to me in that same way. I would love, honestly love, to have conversations about what it means to follow the one who preached so long ago these radical yet simple concepts. For the rest of us, take this time, take this week as a week of renewal, thinking about our place following Jesus and what he said and what he didn't. And again, please be safe as we continue on this Memorial Day weekend. Please join me in prayer. Holy and gracious God, when we come to you in prayer, we know that you are indeed listening. And we know that the Lord's Prayer is sometimes hard to follow. Be with us and show us the way. In your Son's name we pray, amen. Go in peace. God bless.